Deeper Insights into the Illuminati Formula by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 18. Chapter 7, The Science of Structuring. A. Structuring of MPD Worlds. Working with parts of the mind. Control alters called processors. Basic designs of an alter system. Rings the Ferris wheel subsystem multiplex. Data entry points. Testing alters to see if they can be used. The scripts. Assassination models, delta models. Authority factors are maximized. Accountability and anonymity. Monkey alters. Plant alters. Presidential models. Prostitute models. Psychic models. Reporting alters. Rapunzel alter. Transformation alters. Internal wall alters. Structuring internal programmer alters. Structuring with the Grand Druid Council. Structuring the shadow alters. Structuring in the mirrors. Structuring the tapestry. Structuring the altar families by spinning. The programmers are experts in knowing how to mold the clay of blank dissociated parts of the mind into whatever piece they need. The following is a true account. The Chinese arrested a foreigner skilled in martial arts. They abused the man, but instead of becoming apathetic, he kept himself mentally and physically fit in spite of the horrible conditions of his solitary cell. The superstitious guards believed he was a magician. When the identity of the man was discovered, and the Chinese realized that he was one of the world's greatest martial arts experts, they decided to try everything possible to destroy him. He was tortured, starved, and humiliated. The man simply went into dissociative states of trance and endured the tortures without sign of pain or emotion. The hardened guards were awed. The Chinese decided to kill the man. They figured that they could place him in a cage with a starved tiger, he'd go into trance and the starved tiger would eat him, and then they could claim that the man had been a coward. They not only wanted the man's life but his reputation. When they threw the much-tortured prisoner into the hungry tiger's cage, the martial arts expert took on the appearance of a demonized man. With a demonic roar, he attacked the tiger, and instantly kicked the tiger's nose. The animal was stunned and disoriented. The man leaped upon the animal from behind, let out a terrifying scream and strangled the animal. In 20 seconds the whole affair was over. The man looked like an incarnation of a tiger himself. In fact, the tiger had instantly feared the man the split second the master had landed in the cage. When the programmers are successful with their structuring, they are able to create alters that match what you have just read about. Our Chinese prison story illustrates the type of end results the Illuminati want from hours of torture and training given to slaves, but how do they achieve such fantastic results? That is what this chapter is about. Some of the programmed skills of the ninjutsu people, the ninja, are now being structured into Illuminati mind-controlled slaves. A disciple of the above prisoner in China wrote, "The ninja were the original practitioners of the art of mind-control programming. They were taught from the cradle that nothing was impossible. Not knowing that a thing could not be done, they proceeded to do it." The Karate Dojo, p. 101. Structuring of MPD Worlds. The purpose of the mind control is to build a system within the mind that is a human robot. It would do no good to torture the slave and get thousands of pieces, fragments of the mind, alter personalities, if these were not structured. Very few multiples have ever really gotten to see the deeper parts of their systems. Working with parts of the mind. For many people who are unfamiliar with MPD, it can be expected that they would find it strange to watch how the programmers or the therapists work with parts of the mind. Most people misperceive the mind as a monolithic entity. In reality, the normal mind is made up of hundreds of independent parts working in cooperation and competition with each other. The top brain researchers, at least many of them, have come to realize that the brain is composed of many independent parts that at times work against each other. For the normal person, some of these parts can be called ego states and some small processes are called by Minsky agents of the mind. For the multiple personality they are called alters, splits, and purpose fragments. A normal person has a society of agents and ego states which are entities or parts of the mind which combine to make the whole thinking mind. A multiple personality does not have a society, but rather a system of parts. Whether a person has a society of agents or a system of alters, everyone experiences his or her mind as a combination of processes, conflicting motives, and internal tensions. In order to bring some cohesion and unity to one's actions, so that a person didn't spend their life going in 50 different directions at once, the mind creates the illusion of self, the self-image. The self-image by necessity must not change rapidly. One of the main reasons the mind creates a self-image is so it can have a single purpose to its actions. One of the functions of a self-image, of anyone, is to prevent rapid changes. Long-range plans could not be pulled off if my personality were like Jane today and Tarzan tomorrow and Cheetah the next day. The mind refuses to change its self-image, even in the face of conflicting data, because self-preservation of a directed life demands continuity from day to day in our personality. Our self-image is a mental construct that stabilizes the mind's numerous processes. It is a global attitude registered in the mind that globally affects thinking in many of the mind's spheres. This is just one reason why the self-images constructed by the programmer for alters are so tenacious, and so difficult to change. Self-images do not want change, they are the restraints, the ball and chain, we subconsciously create so that we can't wreck all of our plans by skipping from one idealistic goal to another without continuity. How convenient it is to be able to construct a single brain with many different alter personalities, each having its own unchanging self-image. Pain and pleasure are two agents which cause the mind to simplify its focus upon either the pleasure or the pain. The brain does not want to focus on anything that is not an immediate issue. This focus on the immediate pain or pleasure by the victim of mind control diminishes the victim from focusing on more complex mental issues. An example of one of world's top experts who realizes how the mind is naturally made up of parts is Marvin Minsky, co-founder of the Artificial Intelligence Lab at MIT, author of The Society of Mind, and who has been an advisor to NASA and the L5 Society. Minsky's research was financed by the government, the Office of the Advanced Research Projects Agency. And he and other researchers in his field got their contracts by the Office of Naval Research. See Society of the Mind, p. 324. His incredible book The Society of Mind has an interesting format where the numerous parts, agents, of the mind are each given their own page in the book. Minsky shows in the book that the mind is a society that arises out of ever smaller agents that are themselves mindless. He does an incredibly good job of explaining how the mind works. Minsky states, in general, we're least aware of what our minds do best. The Illuminati structuring of the MPD's fragmented mind is to create flawlessly working systems that can function without the conscious mind getting involved. In fact, Minsky describes how our conscious minds only get involved in simple mental processes that don't work well, the complex ones that work well usually work without the conscious mind being aware of them. Some readers may be horrified at picturing a baby's mind as made up of nearly separate agencies. But we'll never understand how human natures grow without some theories of how they start. One evidence for separateness is how suddenly infants switch from smiles of contentment to shrieks of hunger rage. In contrast to the complex mixtures of expressions that adults show, young children seem usually to be in one or another well-defined state of activity. Society of the Mind, p. 171. The Illuminati has long realized that they need to split the mind of the child before its various agencies connect and the ego states form and develop their sense of selfhood and personal identity. Although adults can be programmed, the real Illuminati multiple systems are developed from the womb up. How does the mind make decisions? The various parts of the mind compete with each other. All the parts are in a sense equal, none sits at the top of some hierarchy. The mind does not allow any natural part, such as anger, or sloth to be permanently enthroned and to direct the other parts. Too many chiefs and no Indians wouldn't work out. Natural parts cannot order another part around. They must influence that part indirectly. That is why the following examples happen. A young married man decides that he and his wife cannot successfully work out their problems, because she is a programmed multiple in denial, who wants to manipulate his life and destroy it, while he on the other hand wants to be successful in life. One part of him is the loyal to vows part, which refuses to quit the marriage because of the marriage vows. Another part is the goal-setting part, which sees the marriage as an abusive dead end. How does the goal-setting part convince the loyal to vows part to give up, throw in the towel, and move on with life? It must indirectly trick loyal to vows into feeling that its job has been done as well as possible, and that further concern over the vows are excused. Another young man, a student, has his study part of the mind really wanting to focus on some problems, but the bored and sleepy part of him want to go to sleep. His study part of the mind tricks his bored part into allowing study to go to work. He mentally creates a fictitious scare that another student will do better than he, and bored and sleepy are tricked into thinking the problem is much more weighty than it really is. A young woman bribes her eating processes of her mind, that if she follows through with her diet, she'll reward herself with a nice meal, and that other parts of her will be rewarded with other benefits. Rather than simply diet, she must bribe different parts of herself. Of course, if parts of us lie to other parts when they try to bribe ourselves into doing something, if we are not honest with ourselves in giving the reward, then it is harder next time to bribe the part that was lied to. In order for the non-multiples parts to trust each other, they subscribe to a single agreed-upon character, an imaginary ideal self-image. Otherwise, we couldn't trust ourselves to carry out plans. If an ordinary person has amnesia, they could create a different self-image, which again would be an enduring character. By introducing MPD, the programmers create a hidden element of distrust within a person's mind. They no longer can trust themselves, now they must depend upon the stability of the programmer or owner. Now imagine that each of the agents or parts has been manipulated to think that it is a person with a personality and a history in its own little world. Because the mind is such a tremendous computer, it can easily handle such mental processes. The programmer and the deprogrammer/therapist must work at tricking these parts into allowing the mind to do constructive things. I use the word tricking, because what is actually happening is that the therapist or programmer is using language that relates to the language of that part, but it is not language that has much external reality beyond that part. Structuring is the art of using special languages combined with other programming sciences to manipulate these internal worlds of the various parts. Our minds are instruments to solve practical problems. If an alter sees no practical use for a particular knowledge, they will not want to learn it. This natural selecting process by the mind helps isolate an MPD's system of alters, because many alters do not see a need to learn anything outside of their programming. Control alters called processors. Within the system of alters, certain alters are selected to be processors. As a system is used, certain alters are destroyed, disconnected, or regulated. Certain codes are used or changed. A system paraguard is what is used to decipher codes and to distinguish what is currently happening in a system. Basic designs of an alter system. Most Illuminati systems are configured with a universe or star-based system. In other words, the model for all that is put in use is clusters of stars, galaxies, etc. This is used in conjunction with grids that are shaped in various configurations. The ultimate master of the slave, some Illuminati kingpin who is a programmer or working closely with programmers, will design the system so that the entire structure of the system points to himself and Satan. The alters will be geographically set up in their internal world to worship the master to whom they must give their body, soul, and spirit. A cube or double cube system is a closed system. The programmers who use cubes love to build boxes within boxes. The smallest middle box of the system may contain the life force of the system. Those who love paper trails will see the occult basis for the standard Illuminati cube shape of a system portrayed on page 83 of Clausen Commentaries on Morals and Dogma, which was put out by the Supreme Council of the World of 3-3 of Freemasonry in 1974. This Masonic book explains that the cube represent man and the pyramid is divinity. Divinity within a man would be constructed by placing a pyramid within a cube, which is shown in a picture on page 83. You will also notice in this Masonic book that the two grand masters on page 83 are wearing crowns that have 13 jewels. The crowns serve the same purpose that rings patterned on a similar pattern represent. Crowns and rings represent authority, and it is common within the mystery religions to place 12 or 13 gems within crowns and rings. The reason that this is important, is that some important Masonic/Illuminati secrets are here, and these secrets also pertain to how the mystery religions, the Illum, and Freemasonry, construct an altar system. Rings. Within the Illuminati, which is the continuation of the mystery religions of Babylon, the ring has for many centuries represented divinity. The mystery religion's higher understanding was that God had a ring with his name on it that showed his authority and exercised power over the earth, and that Satan imitated this manifold in all the mystery religions that he created. For thousands of years, within the various mystery religions, hierophants have been wearing rings with particular secret symbols. The zodiac signs were assigned different stones, gems. For instance, the 12 gems of Revelation 21:18-20, which are the usual gems placed within an Illuminati altar system, would correspond to the astrological signs as follows: Jasper, Pisces, Sapphire, Aquarius, Chalcedony, Cancer, Emerald, Taurus, Sardonyx, Scorpio, Chrysolite, Sagittarius, Beryl, Leo, Topaz, Gemini, Chrysoprasus, Capricorn, Jacinth, Amethyst, Aries. The creation of a monarch system's gems is in imitation of the rings of Lucifer and God, as the Illuminati understand it. This ring of gems is able to control the fruit of the trees, programs, and change the internal weather. It is based upon the story that is told the altar system that is being made about how God had a ring. Until his hand swept the heaven of air, first heaven, fruit could not fall and die, because nothing could die. Satan and his followers like rings because they want to be godlike. That doesn't mean all Satanists understand their own history. When an altar is concerned about don't lose the ring, the altar may be referring to the ring of the gems that surrounds the pyramid at the base of the mind. This ring of gem altars may be referred to as the eternal ring, and the ring of fire. The achievement of divinity by a human was what constituted the hermetic marriage of the mysteries. This was the ultimate achievement by mankind. This was symbolized by a gold ring. Within the Illuminati, which is a continuation of the mystery religions, rings are used for bonding, marriage commitments, and a sign of majesty or rank, such as your Masonic rings, and the ring Pharaoh gave Joseph, and King Saul's ring, and special papal rings allowed cardinals and abbots. The Pope has three significant rings, one of which is for ceremonies, and another the important fisherman's ring, which is still used as the Pope's seal. Within the Illuminati altar systems, the seven seals of Babylon are placed into a system. The cube with a pyramid was portrayed at the 14th Masonic degree, the perfect Elu degree. The four horsemen and the seals of Babylon are talked about at the 17th Masonic degree, Knight of the East and West. Also deep within a system may be the Ring of Fire. Within the pyramid, which is within the ring of those 12 gems mentioned in Revelation 21, is the eternal life force, a green light coming from Lucifer. In other words, the secret heart of the system is based upon the original lie, that man could become an eternal god. The Illuminati altar structure has at its heart the original lie. An example of how rings and demonology and authority intersect, can be seen in the grimoire of the Testament of Solomon, where a ring is said to have been given to Solomon which enabled him to learn the names of demons. Rings and chains around the neck are also worn for the extremely secret reason that the wearer is identifying himself with Lucifer, who was bound by God by a ring of fire and was chained in the abyss. This is what is really behind high-ranking Illuminati Freemason and clergyman Robert Schuller's chain around his neck. The highest levels of the Illuminati have the understanding that Lucifer lost his power when Christ bound him, and that in identification with him, they wear gold chains around their neck, etc. Don't expect to read this in the material that occult world is permitted to read, these are high-level secrets. Remember, there are many different levels of occultism and Satanism. In the early Middle Ages, Christians borrowed the idea of having marriage rings from the pagan Germans and Romans. The determination of what finger to wear it on, what has become known as the ring finger, was chosen by the ancient witches because that was considered the only healing finger. Christians, of course, by and large, know nothing of the pagan origins and symbology of the rings they wear. This author has noted that many of the handlers, programmers, and Illuminati adepts wear rings. Some of the rings are quite big. The Ferris wheel subsystem. A Ferris wheel configuration which creates compartments shaped like a piece of pie is often a small part of a larger system, and is used to house altars, or it may have some other internal purpose with its rotation. As was brought out in Volume 2, the Illuminati like to use configurations that appear endless, such as circles within circles, boxes within boxes, triangles within triangles. Star configurations are popular Illuminati power sources within their altar systems. The position of a star, the number of points it has, and the relationship it has to other objects in the sky, such as a rainbow, will be significant. Some stars are placed into the system to represent a point in time when the system is programmed to do something. When a slave is programmed with multiple functioning subsystems, aka systems, the Illuminati call it multiplex. In such as case, types and names of altars may be duplicated in systems that are mirror images of each other or of a similar design. Traver reports that one multiplex system had 55 daves per subsystem with 7 subsystems, making a total of 385 dave altars for the 7 subsystems in just one particular slave. See Traver, Dan. Dissociative Disorders and Mind Control, p. 84. The construction of an Illuminati system cannot be divorced from the demonology and rituals that are performed throughout the life of the system. The Illuminati use mystical terms when programming, which reframes psychological processes in the language of magic. Programming and hypnosis are referred during programming as spells. The programmers will use fictional magical names for items. For instance, the subconscious mind may be referred to as the hypnogourd, a vine that grows gourds. Creativity and imagination will be termed magic, and the programmer a magician. The programmer would instruct his assistant in language like this: would you put this gap forget spell in? The generational spirit, or spirits from each occult bloodline, is laid into the child in the womb. It stays hidden deeply in the system, and plays a fundamental role in the system's creation, empowering other demonic forces. In order to construct the trees that provide the structure for the internal world's programming, the Illuminati programmer will tell the victim the following hypnotic ritual. As you breathe, remember to sit erect, and as your spine straightens, feel the energy rising. Pause. Now imagine your spine is the trunk of a tree, and from its base roots reach down deep into the earth. Pause into the center of the earth herself. Pause and you can draw up power from the earth. With each breath short pause, feel the energy rising, like sap rising through a tree trunk, and feel the power rise up your spine, feel yourself becoming more alive, with each breath, and from the crown of your head, you have branches, that sweep up and back down to touch the earth. Pause and feel the power burst from the crown of your head, and feel it sweep through the branches until it touches the earth again, making a circle, making a circuit, returning to its source. The part of the system that will function within the Illuminati hierarchy will all be intimately part of either the spirit tree, that is the Kabbalistic tree of life, or the tree of evil, which is the evil mirror image of the tree of life. Both trees were discussed in the Volume 2 Formula book. These trees are both totally connected to the spirit of the Antichrist and rooted in Lilith and Tubal-Cain. The moon child ritual is not only performed when the child is still a foetus, but also at age 3, 4, 5, 6, and 16. When the Illuminati child is in their teens, they do the Kabbalistic Tree of Life path working. The path working rituals are severe, and many splits of the mind will occur due to these rituals. All the altars created during this work will be arranged at the gateways that pertain to that particular ritual. Therapists who do not realize how the path working of the 22 paths develops entire sections of deeper altars, may incorrectly think they can simply toss out the Kabbalistic tree of life from the victim. Countless deeper altars are part of this tree. It has been said in the Illuminati that in general an Illuminati system consists of the Father, Core, the Son, the Programming, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit Tree also called the Tree of Life, dot. Data entry points. The programmers have designed their systems so that one can only get into the systems via a sequence. However, sometimes they themselves want to quickly download information into the computer-like mind of their slaves, and they don't want to have to go through a sequencing procedure. For quick and sloppy downloading of information to their slave or quick deletions to the programming, there is only limited access to quick deletions. Programmers put data entry points into most systems. This allows for an emergency entry and slash or downloading. General codes most often open these points, rather than long specific codes. The trick is being able to know where those data entry points are on the person's altar grid or, as the programmers say, the slave's screen. With the advent of laptop computers, what the master of the slave sees if he has to refer to his own reference notes is just that, a screen with the system's layout. Volume 2 PG 88 gave a sample of how a page on the laptop computer or in a master's black or gray three-ring binder would look like. An example of a data entry point would be a gatekeeper which has learned the entire system via trained LSD trips and then has been programmed to keep this understanding on a subconscious level. Testing alters to see if they can be used. When a trauma is carried out upon a child, the child is then debriefed and all the splits from the trauma identified. Generally only the first 10 splits will be used to create alters, and the rest of the splits will become special purpose fragments. The programmers begin with the first split and identify how strong the split is. The programmers test for four things. A. How well can this split take a hypnotic suggestion? B. How creative is this split? C. Can this split hold memory? D. Can this split hold the structuring that will give it? If the split passes positive on these four criteria, then it will be used to make a full-blown alter. The programmers move down the line, testing the splits in the sequence that they were created. If number 4 split is unable to pass the four criteria, then they know that the rest of the top splits will also have to be thrown away and used as special purpose fragments. If they need 12 splits from an altar, and they only get 5 usable splits from the first torture, they will re-detour the altar to get more first splits. They will continue the process until they get the splits they need. Usually they can use the first 10 splits. Seldom do they use anything beyond the first 10 splits for alters, they are just too weak mentally. If an alter shows extra promise, the programmer may say, this part was going to be a bit part, but we'll make her into a real character. If a special purpose fragment leans in a needed direction mentally, they may take what was to be a minor part, and develop it into an interesting alter. Alters that are waiting to be used are stored as gems that the dwarfs mine, and then the programmers program them. An Illuminati system has thousands of these clean slates. Diamonds are pre-programmed alters that are stored to be used in the end times during the reign of the Antichrist. The scripts. Each master programmer is responsible for the scripts that he uses. He will invoke the leading geographic spirits, and even Lucifer to gain up-to-date wisdom on what is best for that time at that location. A master programmer will get assistance from his Mother of Darkness or Grande Dame. The master programmer may use a written script of his own, such as Michael Aquino uses his own version of Star Wars, or he may borrow from established sources, for instance, Dr. Star of Corpus Christi, Texas, who uses the Goetia, the Lesser Key of Solomon the King, Clavicula Solomonis Regis. Dr. Star especially uses the Shemamphorish, which is the first part of that ancient magical book. Recently Avon Books, which has been owned by Hearst Illuminati family, and which has published over 30 editions of the Satanic Bible, published a book by Piers Anthony entitled Visual Guide to Xanth. This amazing book Visual Guide to Xanth is based on Anthony's Xanth series. It contains so many programming scripts, that it is hard to imagine that Anthony is not a programmer. The scripts are too intact for it to be coincidence. The title page has a hoof-tailed Satan on his throne. It is popular among Satanists to use X words, like Michael Aquino signs off his personal letters Zeeper, rather than sincerely. Anthony was born in Britain but now lives in Florida. He has had over 60 fiction books published, many of the early ones were very well promoted by the Illuminati, and became top bestsellers. The back cover advertises this visual guide to Xanth this way: learn about the astonishing hierarchy and lowerarchy of sorcerers and shape-changers, of goblins, harpies, and half-humans who inhabit this extraordinary universe. Internal worlds explore the perilous Ogrefen and the inner chambers of the mysterious castle Runa. Revel in the history and culture of the most remarkable civilization this side of Oz. The co-authors would have to agree that Piers Anthony's storytelling ability rivals, if not surpasses, Baum's Oz series. In fact, Anthony has put out numerous series of books, not just one series like Baum. The Xanth series is the one that contains more of the programming scripts. For instance, a script would be used to get suicide alters to want to take drugs and champagne on an empty stomach, or to get into a bathtub of water and throw in an electric blow dryer, which is on. Assassination models, Delta models. A great deal was explained in the Volume 2 book about Delta alters, Delta models, Delta teams, and Delta forces. All of these are involved with killing humans. It is not the purpose of this section to cover what has already been written in the Volume 2 formula book on these various deltas. Mind-controlled amphibious men, genetically altered Navy SEAL, see Volume 2 p. 26-1-262, the latter no is a significant no, for these programmed men are the Navy's attempt to get something similar to what is depicted on the film Universal Soldiers. These Navy SEALs are not allowed to be touched by other sailors when they are on a ship. There is still a number of deeper insights that can be provided to understand how assassin personalities are conditioned to be able to kill. Researchers in how the brain functions have found that our four brains, the thinking part that makes us humans, shut down when we are angry or frightened, and the midbrain, which resembles the brain of animals, takes over. The only programming that works for the midbrain is the same type of training that works for dogs, which is classical and operant conditioning. This type of conditioning is simply stimulus response, such as if fire bell then walk the fire escape exit plan. When it comes to killing, the forebrain will listen to many suggestions, such as orders from a gang leaders, an officer, or the pressures of life when they demand that a person kill, but the midbrain has the instinct that is born into 98% of the population not to kill another human. This innate human resistance to killing is far stronger than has popularly been realized, and has historically stopped most people from killing. This may surprise most readers, because Hollywood movies would lead us to think otherwise. A number of top researchers, including L.T. Col. Dave Grossman, author of the excellent book on killing, have uncovered irrefutable, albeit still controversial, proof that historically most soldiers have secretly refused to kill in battle. Grossman was a military psychology professor at West Point, as well as having a long list of other military credentials. His superb book on killing gives numerous reasons, proofs and evidences, that numerous soldiers have typically only pretended to try to kill the enemy. Many fired over the heads or only pretended to fire their weapons, if even that. During WW2, Brig. General S.L.A. Marshall discovered that only 15-20% of men on the front line would actually use their weapons against the Germans even during action over several days. 75% of the American soldiers would not even fire at the enemy to save their own lives. He made some suggestions on how to improve this dismal firing rate. By operant conditioning, the U.S. military took those dismal firing rates to 55% in the Korean War and to a 95% firing rate in the Vietnam War. What are behavior modification techniques that turn teenagers into reliable killing machines? These conditioning and psychological tricks are the same methods that are used on the Delta alters and the Delta systems of total mind-controlled slaves, and we will discuss those next. The factors that are weighed as an equation in the human mind to determine whether a human will kill another human are as follows. What is the benefit of the kill? How do recent experiences relate to the victim? How much physical, cultural, moral, social, and mechanical distance is between the killer and the target? The more distance, the easier it gets. How intense is the demand from some authority to kill, and legitimate is this authority? If the killer respects the authority that is asking for him to kill, and is in close proximity of that authority, he will likely obey that authority. Are there a group dynamic working, and if so, what is the power and legitimacy of this group to absolve the killer from guilt? Are there any stumbling blocks from unresolved guilt from previous killings? What is the temperament of the potential killer? Authority factors are maximized. In the programming, the programmer can set himself up as God, or a god. The programmer may also be a satanic cult leader, which further increases the victim's regard for his power and authority. The programmers of total mind-controlled slaves have tremendous potential to cause their assassin alters to overcome any resistance to kill. Accountability and anonymity. A Delta model with many multiple alters incorporates a built-in ability to remove personal accountability. If need be, the person can split off a new personality to perform a particularly odious job. The alters form a peer group which works just like a military unit to inhibit the natural reluctance to kill. This is because the closer a group of persons is, and the closer bonded, the more powerful the enabling. When military units lose 50% or more, the men often lose the will to continue killing, because the group dynamic fizzles out. The programmers who program in the programming, and then later the programmers who program in specific killing missions, have worked long hours ensuring that the assassin alters feel morally distant, superior, and socially distant. The victim is made out to be an inferior being who deserves to be punished and killed. The killer will be doing a great service to his fellow man and country to kill the target. It may be refrained as if it is a holy mission, almost a crusade. Oftentimes the target is not even spoken about in human terms. Perhaps the target is hypnotically portrayed as an ant, a bug, or some wild beast, or simply a target. Hitler helped his military to kill by labeling non-Germans as Untermensch, subhumans. The Americans called the communist Vietnamese gooks, and they in turn called Americans monkeys. Because the mind-controlled assassin will not see the face of their victim due to hypnotic programming, they are also limited in seeing the humanness of their victims. Most of the missions for Delta slaves allow them to kill without the threat of being killed. But the programmer may put the fear of being killed into the slave. They may hypnotically see some object of victim as a threat. One killer, due to programming, saw the men she killed as having a big penis that would hurt her, so her instinct to survive would kick in to help her assassinate these men. Practice is given to assassins with situations similar to actual hand-to-hand killings to desensitize them to close-range killing. With mind-controlled slaves, usually actual live victims are used to get the slaves totally desensitized to killing. Because assassin parts are stripped of conscious thinking and empathy, they are handicapped to really think about what they are doing to another human when they kill. Still, the intelligence agencies and the Illuminati know that somehow the brain still can latch onto guilt, somehow the brain still can perceive in some dim way that it is guilty of killing another human, so they cover their tracks by warrior cleansing rituals. Warriors and soldiers have traditionally done cleansing rituals when they finish a war. An example of a cleansing ritual would be a parade at the end of the war, where the country turns out to tell the soldiers what a great job they did. A programmed assassin in many cases cannot receive a parade, but he can be given lots of praise for having done a great job for humanity, or his country, or whatever ideal the programmer uses as a rationale. Clock time programming. The victim may see their head as a clock and may be tortured in such a fashion. 12 o'clock is straight up between the eyes. 6 o'clock is straight below the chin. Monkey alters. The creation of animal alters has been covered in previous locations in this book and Volume 2. However, I felt Lynn Moss Sharman's description of monkey programming was worth including here. Lynn is a victim of mind control living at Halifax, Nova Scotia. In her description of the memory that goes to her drawing number 29, she quotes what was said during the cages, "You stupid monkey." into your cage. Hit her and put her back in her cage. Lights on. Monkey time. Monkey business. Plant altars. In the older models, they used plants and fruit, but in some of the newer models it appears that they are using samphires, combination beast-plant creatures, and hamadryads, man-plant creatures. Magic from underground springs is the cover story for how these plant-animal hybrids are made. Presidential models include both children and adults. They carry NWO messages to world leaders. They often have passports with accordion editions stapled in, because they do so much traveling overseas. Presidential models are kept in numerous locations. If high-level individuals need to slip away for nefarious use of slaves, they employ look-alikes to stand in for them, while they do their dirty activities. This is why presidents such as Clinton and Bush got away with sexually using far more slaves than their schedule seems to indicate. Bush was a pedophile, while his double, who has recently lived in France, was a womanizer. Prostitute models. Slaves designed to function as prostitutes must receive training to protect themselves. One possible problem might be a female prostitute who is accosted by an aggressive male, when she is not to allow herself to be used by him. She can be trained to jump up, slap the man on the face, warn him that she kick his testicles next time, and then kiss the man in a submissive makeup fashion to smooth his bruised ego. A prostitute slave will also receive code words to let people, say people in a casino, know who she is. Deeper prostitute parts which need to perform sex for long periods of time accomplish this for their masters by switching alters and by ingesting speed. The mechanical nature that sexual alters have is illustrated by the "I can walk, I can talk" phrases of alters with doll programming. Psychic models. Both men and women slaves were created to carry out various psychic functions. For instance, the Antichrist needs to be able to look at people and totally understand them psychologically and their systems of mind control, alter systems, programming, etc. The abilities to successfully perform psychic functions have been tested for years before they were created within the Antichrist. Reporting alters. The construction of reporting alters is very straightforward behavior modification. For programming reporting alters, they use purpose fragment splits. In other words, these reporting alters are not given the full range and exposure to life, but they experience life from the vantage of their single purpose. Some therapists are reporting that they are converting reporting alters over by giving them ice cream. They are most likely only dealing with fronts. Since most therapists only deal with front alters, and front systems, these front reporting alters may even be set up so that these therapists think they have converted the reporting alters. The truth is that most of these reporting alters are fragments that don't know what hunger is. All the ice cream in the world is going to mean anything to them. Cisco will deal with these issues in her part of this book. The point is simply, these are special purpose fragments who only see life from the vantage point of their little job. Now we will explain what first and second stage reporting alters are, and then how they are created. Some of the first stage reporting alters are trained to respond to three taps, some to telephone calls, lights, and some to codes. The first stage alters are children from 6 to 10. In an Illuminati system, there will be families of reporting alters. Every level, section, will have at least one group, family, of reporting alters. The second stage reporting alters are also children from 6 to 10, and they are taught to want daddy's or mommy's love. Girl systems seek daddy, the master, and boy systems often seek mommy, the master. They are taught to talk about therapy issues, programming issues, and movements by the system. They are linked to the computers, and the eye of the computer. Just to hear daddy's voice is gratification to them. At stage one of the creation of reporting alters, they are the result of the sensory deprivation tank, and are taken from the dissociated part of the mind that feels like it doesn't have a body, or that it is nothing. Stage 1 reporting special purpose fragments of the mind are painfully shocked in some sensory deprivation environment when they hear three taps. The pain ceases when they open the door. they continue to be locked in place in the mind and painfully shocked until they learn the lesson, which is that the pain stops when the door is opened. Over and over they are taught, the pain stops when the door is opened. When they hear tapping, they want the pain to stop. Probably they abreact their previous tortures, and they open the door to stop the pain. They have only one job, stop the pain by opening the door when three taps, or whatever other trigger/code/signal they are programmed for. Stage 2 reporting special purpose alters are given a fuller view of life. They are the watchers in the system. They were created under such horrible torture that they left the body and hover over the body. These are out-of-body alters. They are also placed in a fogged room, where they are taught to become one with the fog. They are also told ghost stories like Casper the Ghost. Through the combination of all these programming tactics and techniques, they learn to be invisible. They hover over their assigned position in the system, invisible to all the other alters of that section. These alters have excellent rapid recall. They have none of the straw man programming that gatekeeper received to make them think they are stupid. To reinforce the programming, the reporting alters are always treated kindly when they obey. If you get one that hasn't been, suspect a plant, a setup. Internal protector alters are given the job to ensure that reporting alters never miss a call, or never miss responding to a cue. They will go to work and punish lax stage 1 alters. Again, several therapists claim to have gotten reporting alters to defect from their jobs, but haven't dealt with their protector alters who are taskmasters. If the taskmasters haven't been dealt with, then suspect a ruse to get the therapist to think all is well. The reason this subject is dealt with here, is that some of the top well-known therapists have spread information contrary to what is actually happening. That doesn't mean that there may not be an exception to the rule, but the Illuminati is not so stupid as to make reporting alters that defect because someone offered them an ice cream cone. Reporting alters are very hard to convert, because during their lifetime they are treated nicely. They experience a nice life if they behave, it's the other alters that suffer. The stage 1 reporting alter merely says hello and waits for the response, "Hello princess." This is a standard format. If the "Hello princess" occurs, the mind automatically in a flash switches to the stage 2 reporting alter. To reinforce the original programming, which would lose its effect over time, the programmer hypnotically command the reporting alters to think of their programming when they see certain objects, for instance, certain types of men's clothing, animals, certain cigarettes or lighters, certain trees, etc. Everyday life is used then to reinforce their programming. The stage 1 alters are also trained to have backup amnesia, where they forget what they have done after they have responded to the cue. Once the job is done, the job is forgotten. Like the Volume 2 book reported, reporting alters can perceive themselves in various shapes and figures, and they can be locked up in eggs or other containers also. The stage 2 alters look forward to daddy or mommy coming. Cisco's system, which helped at the programming level, verifies that during the 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s none of the slaves got free. The Illuminati was not the least bit concerned about losing a slave. They had not lost a mind-controlled slave in centuries, so the recent victories in a few slaves getting their freedom in recent years are a historical first. Many therapists who make great therapeutic claims are not freeing their slaves at all, but these slaves continue to be used by their masters. The masters just laugh at the deceptions they have pulled over legitimate but naive therapists. Their reporting alters are a key to their control, and they have numerous reporting alters in families spread throughout a standard reporting system. If one realizes that the same mentality that created Stalin's USSR, or that created Big Brother is at work here, you will realize that they need a spy in the camp on every block, so to speak. Everybody watches everyone. They make many spies within a system of alters. The reporting alters are given some scripts, such as you can diffuse from super solidity to insubstance, you can grow big or small, and can change shape to any for you wish. This makes it easier for them to go through the internal system. Rapunzel alter. In the internal Mothers of Darkness castle there is often a Rapunzel alter created by the Rapunzel story, who who has magical hair and can change her size at will. She is not an Illuminati altar, even though she resides at their castle. Transformation altars. In Chapter 5, in the section on how Fantasia was used as a programming script, the fairy altars, creative parts of the child's mind, were discussed. The Illuminati also create magical altars that can transform other altars into objects. The script for this is Alice in Wonderland, although some newer scripts are also being used, like Xantha's sorceress Vadni. When an altar is changed into an object, it does so without losing its character. This is where cartoons have been helpful to lay the foundation for visualizing this. When one enters particular internal rooms, one needs to pick up certain objects in the room to get through portals to the next world. What makes the internal world difficult is that it is set up to change its appearance. An altar may think they see one thing internally and then the scene totally shifts. An altar may look into a mirror and turn into a leaf. Internal wall altars. Some altars will be made into walls. This is why it can be difficult to go around internal walls. These altars shift so that no one can get around them. Structuring internal programmer altars. The procedure for the creation of internal programmer altars is several steps. After the child victim has been traumatized, they are sorely in need of love. Using a drug that gives a sense of peace and ecstasy, along with hypnosis, certain parts of the system are bonded to the programmer. The child alters are told to forget the trauma and merge with the programmer. Its instinct to want to be loved, touched, and comforted. This is repeated so that they feel the peace of God with their three primary abusers. Scriptures about the peace of God are used to reinforce this programming. These alters who feel one with the master programmer will form a cover group which will pacify any front alters who think negatively about the external programmer. These alters are in turn used to build the actual programmers. The actual programmers will be programmed to take on the characteristics of the master programmers and the grand dame working with them. These alters will be formed via split-brain programming, so they have only logic, no emotion. They can interact for years with the rest of the system and will feel no emotion for the hell and abuse that they put hundreds of other alters through. These controllers will stand behind the Grand Druid Council to ensure that they carry out their function correctly. Structuring with the Grand Druid Council. In Illuminati mind-controlled slaves, it is typical to place at the bottom of the system a pyramid-shaped table with a crystal prism life force within the pyramid center. Around this pyramid table are the Grand Druid Council, and Satan hovers over the entire thing. Mirrors on both sides surround the pyramid. The Grand Druid Council can astrally project and attend rituals. There are cover councils to throw the unapproved seeker off. In fact, every section within the slave may have a Grand Druid Council. These are not the computers, but function closely with the computers. When the life force dies, it becomes black. The slave will told that the life force of the system is within the pyramid, which is inside the Grand Druid Council's table. The pyramid will spin constantly from the energy of Lucifer, and the Grand Druid Council may well spin on their table in the opposite direction. Each position on the Grand Druid Council, GDC, is significant, because it determines what that council person is allowed to do. This is a mirror of real life. The type of programming and commands that a particular council person can carry out are determined by their position around the table. The number 3 position has access to the center pyramid. Within the spinning pyramid are 3 programmer positions, one for each corner of the triangle. If only one programmer occupies all 3 positions, you are dealing with a master programmer. Very often a system is programmed by lesser programmers, and the inner pyramid has more than one programmer inside the pyramid. If a group/series of cult programmers is used, one may see them represented somewhere in the system by their cult names. Growing through the Grand Druid Council's table will be the generational demonic roots of a tree. Tied up at the base of the tree, entwined in the roots, is the life force of a foetus that has been sacrificed to empower the slave's mind control system, as well as connect the slave to people that he or she is teamed with. During a cult ritual, the foetus is eaten as a seed. The dead child is connected to the roots. Another child, the child who is connected to the memory of these rituals, will also be connected to the root of the tree. This child altar will not be able to talk or scream because it is locked in the horrible memories of some humiliating ritual. This child altar may have things in its penis or rectum, it may be covered with filth, its skin is bruised and tender. This may be the core-the birth child. In male slaves, sometimes the birth child or a first core split called the core is placed in the tree roots rather than the carousel. Egg-shaped demonic power bases will also be set in at the root of the tree. The core of some slaves will be removed to the astral plane. The Grand Druid Council will astral project to different spheres and different ceremonies. This gets into black magic such as the 777 Book of Aleister Crowley touches on, where there are colors for each planet for astral projection. While we are discussing the deeper parts to a system, let's discuss the compass. Each system has a compass built into it, that is incredibly important. The four demons, goddesses, which control the four directions are called quarter regents. The eastern one controls wind and air. The northern one controls the elemental earth. The western one controls water realms. And the southern one controls fire. Structuring the shadow altars. Altars which are created in the sensory deprivation tanks which have no sense of being attached to a body are used in clusters on each level, section or world, of an Illuminati system of altars. These altars are the ones who no one else can see because they have no body, and yet they are the shadows that know what's going on in the outside world. Every level has access to what is going on in the outside world through the eyes of these shadow altars, but many altars do not care. Nor will the shadow altars tell everyone on the level. These clusters of shadows are also chained together, so that a link exists between them. They have no sense of self. They sometimes serve as directors to guide the child slave. They may protect the child by telling it to get home, to call home, or to not be frightened, it will be okay. They are also willing to mislead therapists. Structuring in the mirrors. One of the movies which was developed to help program in the internal mirrors was the movie The Hungry Glass, made in the early 50s. Let's review The Hungry Glass movie so that those who aren't familiar with it can see the programming elements of the movie. The movie is about a fictitious haunted mansion that was built near the sea by a rich man named Bellman. The mansion lays dormant for decades until a couple buy the mansion. The mansion and its window is described as a jewel box to pull the silver off the sea. When they move in, they experience many strange things connected with mirrors and glass. In the monarch programming, glass and mirrors are similar. Many of the mirrors in a system are really one-way windows. The following are some quotes from the movie. Mirrors bring a house to life. I'm great at turning nightmares into daydreams. Don't know if I saw it. It's imagination playing tricks, never get it out of your system. We're both suggestible to suggestion. Saw something and imagined the rest. Just plain fear. Did I see something supernatural? If you want anything, just scream. Miracles can be done with concentration. I got the house in order with spell, book and candle, which is a phrase referring to witchcraft. You never grow old in the mirrors. When altars of a slave look in a mirror, it happens just like in the movie, they see themselves as young, which is a strong hypnotic image they have been programmed to see. What the movie shows is that it is lethal to break mirrors. And if you go through mirrors, you fall to your death. The one woman as well as a little girl are curious about the mirrors and they are pulled into the mirrors and die. In other words, the programming message is don't be curious about the mirrors nor go into the mirrors. There are demons in the mirrors. In the movie they use the word bogeyman. The room of mirrors is locked, and the message of the movie is, don't open locked doors in your internal system. In the movie, when Gil looks in the mirror, he sees a protector of the mirrors. This in the programming is called the keeper of the mirror, and is a demonic entity or demons placed to protect the mirror. Things are layered and hidden in a system behind mirrors. It also gives the idea that if you look into a mirror, even if you are physically old, the mirror can lie and give you a youthful appearance. Young actor William Shatner, of later Star Trek fame, plays the leading role in the movie. He tries to rationally explain things but gives up when explanations fail. This is encouraging the small slave who would see the movie to think, if an adult can't figure these things out rationally, then the explanations for what I am seeing during programming are supernatural. William Shatner was raised in Catholic Montreal, Quebec, and went to McGill University when Dr. White, UN Cameroon, was carrying out programming there. He graduated in 1952 and married Gloria Rand. He has acted in a number of strange movies designed for programming, and it appears they have used him repeatedly over the years as a tie-in to familiarize the slave to him. He also acted in The World of Susie Wong, 1958, The Brothers Karamazov, 1958, The Devil's Reign, 1978, Tech Lords, 1991. The Hungry Glass was produced by William Fry, who also did some other movies for the network. In some areas of a system, the script is that only the dead-alters who are so disconnected to their bodies they see themselves as spirits are allowed to cross between different internal worlds by using passwords such as Iliad. At other times, alters are given words to return to their own time period such as Necro Nectrum Necto. Structuring the tapestry. A script is given for all standard Illuminati systems for an internal sorceress to be assigned the making of tapestries. The tapestries enable alters to go into other worlds, in other words they are mirror gateways. For instance, the sorceress may weave a door into the tapestry. Going into the mirror, going over the rainbow, going through walls or picture tapestries are ways that alters go from one world into another state. Structuring the alter families by spinning. Spinning is used in a variety of programming purposes. We will review these together, so that a comparison can be made of the different purposes. Spinning tortures, which the victim endures while in drugged hypnotic states, are used extensively by the programmers as they construct alter systems. Programmed multiples will frequently complain of spinning. All at once, whole sections of alters will begin spinning and getting dizzy. During such an abreaction, you will notice that the eyes change, the victim will appear disoriented and stare, or even grimace as if being rotated at a high speed. The head and slash or body will rotate slightly during the abreaction. During the programming of such a spin program, the programmer will lay in the experience for an entire section of alters, and attach the visual image of falling into an abyss, a cyclone, a tornado, a vortex, or a whirlwind to the memory of being spun. When a system goes into spinning, the power of numerous memories, and the power of the dizzy spinning makes it difficult for much of anything. Certain alters trigger the spinning and certain alters maintain the spinning. In fact, some spinning alters take pride in their spinning abilities. Obviously, their programmers commended them when they did their job correctly. Another use of spin tortures is to create spin families. The spin torture creates spin alters which have been spun off a parent alter. The parent alter may later be age-progressed hypnotically and given care over her children alters who she or he spun off during the torture. Spinning is a way of creating dissociation, and the spin memory dissociates the spin children alters from their original source alter. This creates alters which are close together internally, but dissociated. The spin training and memories are then used to teach these alters to spin away the pain. Spin alters are used for some of the worst abuse, and the spinning sensation is used internally by these alters to dissociate the severe abuse they receive. The actual mechanisms to do the spinning torture vary. Some are rotating tables, some are more upright like a Wheel of Fortune type wheel, or space trainer type machine where the victim is inside the rotating mechanism. Flashing lights are used along with the spinning, so that flashing lights can be used in the future to cause the alter, to abreact the spinning sensation. Verbal triggers are also placed in. The spin kittens will actually physically go around when commanded. Certain alters will be trained to recreate mentally the sensations of spinning via enhanced imagery and memory training. This is so that the system will be self-governing and self-propelled. The spin traumas may be used to help create the ring within ring, circle within a circle effect that is structured into so many systems. Programs that are put in via spin-based traumas or attached to spin-based traumas often affect wide areas of a system, rather than individual alters. For instance, if an area of the system is misbehaving, a tornado program, or a tumbleweed program may be set off by the internal governing mechanisms and an entire world of alters will feel the program. Victims of mind control often speak about walls full of different faces. The walls of faces are people who are in need of help. They are shown repeatedly to the victim, to solicit the emotion of wanting to run and rescue. This then is used as the cover program for alters for them to want to run back to the cult to rescue their friends. Generally, all that will be experienced is the memory of walls of faces and the urge to run. Another element of programming, often seen in military programming, is where the victim is left in a totally dark room, and then for men, a hypnotic motherly voice is played repeatedly to them in the dark. For women, they may get their primary handler's hypnotic voice. More structures used to build a system.